burn for paper is being pushed back. So the deadline for that is, instead of what Silva says, Monday, Tuesday, Friday. So papers are due on Friday, September 27th. At the end of class today, I'll give you two handouts that really about writing philosophy papers. Really, I've designed these for intro level classes, but they will be maybe hopefully a helpful review of a few points for you. Two points I want to highlight from these. The first is to make sure your citations are clear. I don't care so much about the exact format, so whether it's a comma after the title or a period, I don't really care very much. What I do care about is that your citations are consistent and clear. So I have to be able, the reader has to be able to find exactly the source, not just the internet or not just a book, but exactly where on the internet, exactly which page in that book. I have to be able to find exactly the place. So your citations need to be precise. Second point is something I stress to my intro students when they're writing their first philosophy paper, but I think I'll mention it again here. It's something I talk about in the handout I'm going to give you. And it's this. At all costs, don't try to sound philosophical. You're writing a paper about philosophy. The topic is already abstract. The topic is already difficult. The topic is already obscure. Your job is not to push it further in that direction. Your job is to push it in the other direction. Your job is to take an idea or a thesis that's already abstract and obscure and difficult and make it clearer. Okay? So, write simply, write clearly. Make sure the organization of your paper is easy to follow. Your job is to bring down these abstract, theoretical, philosophical ideas and explain them in a plain and more simple way so that people can understand what's already difficult and philosophical. And last point, specifically about these, you still need to be sending me an email or coming to my office hours to talk about your topic. This can be just a couple sentences, a few sentences explaining what you're planning to do with a citation for the secondary literature that you need. And I'll say one last time, you can do this by email, but you need to do it before you write the paper. Any questions about that? As I said, I'll hand these out to you. Do take the time to look at this. I mean, this some should be review, but it's a good reminder, I think. Any questions about that? All right, last time we started talking about chapter 14. Just got to maybe the first page or so. And the first point there was Hobbes's account of the right of nature. And the idea here with the right of nature is that everyone, naturally, in the state of nature, is entitled to use his or her own judgment in determining what's valuable, in determining what's good. And therefore, each individual is entitled to rely on their own judgment concerning what is good, which is ultimately, for each individual, tied to their own desires. So each individual can, as it were, let their own desires be their guide to what ends to pursue, what actions to take. And of course, not just, as I say, their judgment, but their actions also. They are entitled to act on the basis of those judgments. And this is an unlimited right that everybody has. And so notice that far from identifying or generating exclusive rights, these rights that get generated by the right of nature conflict very sharply, very, very sharply, from different people. So there's nothing like the state of nature. There's nothing like property, which generates exclusive rights, allows one person to decide how some object will be used, for what purpose or what good, and not others. No, everybody can decide for themselves which objects to use for what purposes in the state of nature. One other way to think about this idea of the right of nature is that naturally, in the state of nature, nobody gets to subordinate anyone else's judgment. Each person is, you might say, equally entitled to decide for themselves what's valuable and what's worth pursuing. So nobody is picked out by God or by nature as having special insight into which things, you might say, really are valuable in themselves. In part because for Hobbes, there's nothing that's really valuable for itself. Things are made valuable for a person, made good for a person, by that person desiring that thing. We all have desires, and so we all make things good for ourselves without having to rely on anybody else's judgment. Questions about that? So that's all sort of an overview of the right of nature. Then we were talking about the idea of a law of nature. And a law of nature is a rule discovered by our own reasoning abilities, telling us how best to achieve our most important goals, how best to satisfy our most important desires. And of course, he's assuming that the way human beings are created, our most important desire is to stay alive, to avoid death. Notice again the reliance here, the crucial reliance here on instrumental understanding of reasoning. Reasoning here is just a matter of figuring out how best to achieve our ends, how best to achieve our goals, which means, which tools, which levers to push, so to speak, are the most effective ways of bringing about the things that we most desire. And I said last time, I'll say again, these rules, these laws of nature, are not imposed on us, are not external constraints on our ability to do what we want. These are just discoveries, so to speak, about the way the world is that tell us how to get what we want, how to achieve what we ourselves already desire, our ends. I think at the very end, we were able to anticipate the most fundamental law of nature. It's no surprise, given that our most important desire is to stay alive, and Hobbes has just argued that in the state of nature, life would be solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short. Okay, so now we can see him actually make this argument. This is on page 80, paragraph 4. And he just says exactly the argument that we would expect. He says that because the condition, so we've now talked about what a law of nature is. And now we're going to start exploring what they are, what their content, what these rules tell us to do. There's the argument. He says, because the condition of man, which I just showed you in the preceding chapter, is a condition of war of everyone against everyone, in which case, everyone is governed by his own reason, and there is nothing he can make use of that may not be a help unto him in preserving his life against his enemies, it follows that in such a condition, every man has a right to everything, even to one another's body. This is just what the right of nature gives us. And therefore, so my right of nature gives me the right to judge what goals to pursue, what's valuable, gives me a right to judge what means to use in achieving those goals, like, for example, using my body to achieve those goals, and it grants me the right to actually act on those judgments. So I can use my own body as a means, as a tool, to achieve whatever goals I take to be good, like preserving my life. But you also can use my body to pursue your goals. No exclusive rights here. So I can use my body, or my right of nature gives me a right to use my body to pursue my goals. Mostly, most importantly, staying alive. But your right of nature gives you the right to use my body to pursue your most important goals, your staying alive. And one way that you might do that, if I'm a threat to you, is to kill me, avoiding the threat to your life. Perfectly fine. The right of nature gives us all of those rights. So, I mean, you can see here, there's a sense in which if this right of nature, this unlimited right that everybody has, that really is kind of the source of the problem in the state of nature. Right? The fact that everybody can do anything that they judge to be in their own interest without limit, that puts people into, well, that allows these conflicts to be, as it were, unregulated, unlimited. Okay, so, and therefore, he says, as long as this right, as long as this natural right of every man to everything endures, as long as we all have this unlimited right of nature, there can be no security to any man, how strong or wise soever he be. We're all vulnerable, so much more powerful than they can be, indifferent to the threat of others, of living out the time which nature ordinarily alloweth men to live. And consequently, okay, so here we go. And consequently, it is a precept or general rule of reason that every man ought to endeavor peace as far as he has hope of obtaining. Okay, so that's just, that's what we talked about last time. The most effective way for you to achieve your most important goals, mostly staying alive, is to try to get out of the state of war of all against all by achieving peace. Okay. So that's it. So that's, in a sense, the fundamental law of nature. But he continues.